So this is Ham Radio Now, episode 311. And I got a title for this one, David, and I'm proud of it.
Okay.
California Drivin'.
California Drivin'.
You know, all the leaves are brown, California. Right.
Yeah.
Got to be old for this one.
Or, no, I got that one.
Subtitled, California Nightmare.
Yeah.
could be. I don't know. Got some guests here in the in Skype land. Somebody's got an airplane going over them.
Not me.
Is it me?
No, it's not me. Yeah, it's probably me. You probably hear the birds in the background, too. We'll see if we can make that go.
So we got me here in North Carolina, and then everybody else is in California. And what we're going to do is talk about the law in California that, David, you and I have discussed briefly on a couple of previous shows that apparently prohibits ham radio mobile operating. We'll find out more about that. Introduce our guests.
Okay, very good. Well, Norm Lucas, and you know what? I wrote the call to signs down somewhere, but I don't have it. So, Norm, what's your call sign?
Whiskey Bravo 6, Radio Victor Radio, WB6RVR.
All right, very good. And Jim Aspinwall, is it Aspinwall?
Yes.
Did I get it right? And what's your call sign?
November Oscar 1, Papa Charlie, number 1 PC.
Right, number 1 PC, very good. Well, thanks for joining us today. And you guys have...
No, you're supposed to mistake it like this. N01PC?
No.
Write it down. N01PC.
I did. I wrote it down. And you're right. Yeah. I wrote it down the wrong way.
You write it down. It looks like N01PC.
That's exactly right. I wrote it down just like my call sign.
If I want to screw people up, I will say I'm K94AQ. Because N, you know, 9.
Right.
It's legit.
Right.
It's confusing, right. But it's legit.
Don't work a lot of DX, do you?
Yeah, it's not gonna help at all. So thank you guys for coming on Ham Radio Now. Before we get to talk to you, we get to talk to our pigs. Arvin East is over here. And Arvin, wait a minute, where's your picture? There. Got to figure out how to do this. There we go. Arvin West. So Arvin East meet Arvin West, and they meet on the website hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy the programs, get something out of them. And I feel like sending us a little spare change, hamradionow.tv. Go to the bottom of the page, click on Arvin's icon. Patreon is a monthly contribution. You can take it as low as $1 a month. It'll be 12 bucks a year. Or individual contributions at PayPal or just credit card to take your pick. And so let's go back to everybody here.
So how did we get here? We got here because of lovely Assembly Bill 1785. And I would read
it. Jim, do you want to kick it off? You want me to start?
I would read it, but I think we'd have listeners tune out right away.
Well, let's start with the actual, or is this it, the Senate bill? No, it's not a bill. This is the current law, right?
Well, that's the law, yeah. So the bill is what started off, and it ended up becoming the law. But yeah, okay. You're right.
So this is, for those that are on audio, we're looking at the California Vehicle Code, the numbers are confusing, but it's Chapter 12, Article 1, driving offenses. I love politicians and lawmakers. A person shall not drive a motor vehicle while holding and operating a handheld wireless telephone or an electronic wireless communications device unless the device is specifically designed and configured to allow voice-operated and hands-free operation and is used in that manner while driving. And there's a bunch of other stuff in here, but the area that I think has caused the most issue, the most heartburn, is the last paragraph, paragraph F. For purposes of this section, electronic wireless communications device include, but not limited to, broadband personal communications device, a specialized mobile radio device, a handheld device, or laptop computer with mobile data access, a pager, or a two-way messaging device. That's pretty all-inclusive, isn't it?
That covers a lot of things.
It does cover a lot of things.
So what does that mean? You guys operate mobile while you're driving?
All the time.
I do too.
Absolutely.
How about you, Gary? You do, right?
I forgot to take a picture of the stuff in my car. That's why for me it's the nightmare, because I got all those radios. Just about everybody on ham radio now has seen them. Are you comfortable with operating with this law on the books? Is anything happening?
It puts you in kind of a defensive or an awareness mode, because you're not sure, who's going to enforce it and how you're going to be noticed for it. We're all familiar with distracted driving laws and hands-free cell phone laws, but when you get to the broad scope of the language is where it's open to interpretation, and it is those interpretations that caught our eye in various ham forums, on Facebook, things you hear over the air and your mailing list. What really drove my attention to this is seeing a bulletin out of law enforcement in Southern California that effectively said, yes, we believe this applies to two-way radio use and amateur radio use, and we're prepared to cite for it. And that drove me back to look at the law and say, well, where does it say, anything specific about this? And then you look at the loopholes that you very keenly pointed out, Gary, and those are the troublesome clauses. I started doing some outreach with the law enforcement, public safety folks I deal with, put out a call to friends. Norm was in that audience. And I said, can somebody get to the highway patrol or the sheriff and find out how they feel about it? And I got a very terse response back, without attribution to anybody in particular, that they were very emphatic that, yes, this does specifically preclude anything of a distraction, and we will enforce it, against two-way radio use as well. And when you get two different law enforcement agencies that say, yes, we're going to apply this to two-way radio, and you have a law that doesn't say that specifically, you start to wonder where the legal interpretation and scope of this is. And calling more law enforcement buddies at county and city levels, one major city north of us here, in their training department, their official bulletin, again, off the record for us, is we don't have time for this. We have too many other things going on in our city to worry about that. There are so many people on their cell phones driving around the bumpy, hilly, windy streets of this big famous town that we have bigger things to worry about. And we've got a pretty good relationship with law enforcement agents at both my local hometown and a couple of neighboring counties. And they said, well, we do this all the time. What's the big deal? So those ambiguities really drove the cause, not knowing exactly where to go for answers, is where the change.org petition started. I said, well, let me get ahead of this. Let me just throw out this petition and see what sticks to the wall. And, 2 months and 1,400 plus signatures later, I guess we caused quite a stir in the Capitol and got a lot of people trying to defend this and a lot of people trying to stick to it.
Change.org petition. Tell me more about that, because that is news to me.
Okay. One way to get a whole lot of awareness, and realizing that this is is going to be bigger than a California issue, realizing that there's no single outlet in California to get a hold of all the California hams or the various recreational or commercial interests. And I said, well, let me just throw it out on change.org. And then take that link and use change.org as the basis for discussion and to garner support rather than just a handful of Facebook groups. So change.org became the pivotal point of drawing attention to this, and that was shared out. And it basically calls for let's repeal or fix what was Assembly Bill 1785, currently the California Vehicle Code, whatever it takes. And citing the reasons that the law is ambiguous. We've all gotten contradictory messages from law enforcement. And through a discussion of that, one of our local OAS emergency communications groups here had one of their members cited in a local community for this very law for microphone use, apparently. And I would love to get his affidavit, but he's a little shy of coming forward. But there's actually been one known amateur radio operator and public safety volunteer that has been cited for this. So that's when it gets scary, when you don't know what's going to happen.
Jim, what part of the state are you in?
I'm in Northern California. I live about 50 miles south of San Francisco in Santa Clara County, Silicon Valley.
Gotcha. And you talked to the Highway Patrol up there and other law enforcement as well, you said?
Yeah, we've reached out through direct and indirect contacts with the Highway Patrol. One of the one of our advocates and partners in this is a CHP employee. We've gotten second, third hand. We're letting the community reach out as much as possible, hopefully to get some attribution. But this really rests for us in amateur radio, and even if you're just a volunteer for a search and rescue team, we all have served agencies that ultimately report to a local law enforcement. In California, the counties are the basis for emergency declaration, emergency management when things go wrong. Various cities will have their initiatives. But the county is really the epicenter for local participation, filtering up to the state. So
I found your change.org petition here on the web. And is that your mobile?
Yes.
Ah, very nice installation. Very nice and clean.
Oh, I'll show you the rest of the gallery. It's kind of an impressive mess.
All right. So 1,436 supporters you need to reach 1,500 by. Is there a deadline?
No, change.org is kind of funny. They just tell you how many more to get. So you don't have to do the math in your head if you want to reach, if you have a specific goal point. And we're going to let it fly out there. It grew to 1,000 rather quickly in the first 3 to 4 weeks and has tapered off a little bit. But out of that, the demographic that I've pulled statistically out of its back end is 95% of those who've signed the petition are California residents, or at least have California addresses.
So I was going to ask, do they have to be California?
Well, no, they don't have to be, because this is not a legal, this is probably not be the basis of a legal petition for the environment. We have since learned through the legislative processes means to issue petitions specific to each assembly district, because laws in California start at the basis of a local assembly representative in the 80 districts in the state. And so we are also have spawned initiatives of having petitions drawn with residents of each of the assembly districts to gain further awareness from local voters, because as we learned the hard way, the assembly people don't care to feed back to you if you're not a voter in their district. Right. You don't count to them effectively. So this
change.org, this is just an attention getting thing. It is not official in any way at all.
No, but we can draw from this, and we have in the case of a specific petition to Assembly Member Quirk, who's the bill's author. We have extracted addresses and people from the database who live in his District 20, and they became the signature basis for an official petition to his office. And we'll continue to do that with the initiatives Norm and I are working on, going to hamfests and club meetings. We will qualify people who are interested in signing a specific signature sheet per district, and then we'll continue to extract the addresses out of the change.org petition and attach those to it as well.
All right. For the folks that are just listening and not able to see the screen, this is what you're asking for, to constrain the legislation to its original focus as a cell phone bill.
Yes.
To strike any broad and other devices type language that suggests that it's something besides cell phones and smartphones. As much as possible and practical, exempt and exclude fixed installation devices with passive components and accessories that do not require both visual and tactile distraction to operate. Tethered attached radio. I have no idea what I just read. What is that?
Well, that was a very early attempt, and since these things become fluid, you know, like writing a draft chapter in a drama, you throw characters and behaviors and events and situations out there. In some of my actual proposed rewording for the bill, we're a little clearer, but it's an attempt to try and capture and characterize the nature and the behavioral use of equipment used in two-way radio versus the immersive behavior of picking up your cell phone, which you are, you know, you're right in front of that. You're very much immersed in it versus reaching over and muscle memory, grabbing a mic, saying, okay, hello, I can do this. I can function with the world around me, put the mic down, and I've not really distracted myself from doing so.
Okay, so there's one more paragraph. Ensure consistency in the detection and enforcement advice to all agencies and law enforcement organizations, to the extent of recognition of basic communications devices that are less complex than the devices employed in their jobs. What do you mean there?
Well, as has come out in a lot of the comments, is if you've been in a modern law enforcement vehicle or a fire engine or an EMS vehicle, there's at least one radio in there. There's a mobile data computer. There's a laptop, a hardened laptop fastened down. There may even be a GPS. There's tons of electronic apparatus in a public safety vehicle. And we know here that drivers who drive Code 3 equipment in emergency situations are trained to drive those vehicles under very stressful conditions. But nowhere do we know of are they trained to drive those vehicles and deal with the gadgets that are around them. So we're trying to, and we'll probably reword that a little bit so it makes more sense. Thank you for pointing that out. You know, the editor's critique is always helpful. But it's to try, one of the challenges brought to us in discussing this with the Assemblyman's office and his law enforcement advocates that we're working on this is the challenge is, why should you be any different than, why should we allow you to do this? And there's kind of a smattering of, and some people say, well, police officers do this, and they're special people. And I go, well, not necessarily. They're not trained to use that equipment any differently in the pursuit of their jobs than some of us who've been practicing this for 40 years. So,
All right, this is a good spot for me to show a little video that I found. Speaking of people using two-way radios in their professions, this is a news story from a TV station in New York, not New York City, but someplace in New York State. I'm not sure when it first came out. It's fairly recent, and I think we'll spend a couple minutes checking this out. Ham radio will play a part in it at the very end, so if you're itchy about ham radio, it'll show up.
School bus drivers, they have an important job getting your kids to and from school, but is a handheld device distracting them? It's the subject of this week's Good Question Report with Pat Daney.
School bus drivers are not allowed to use cell phones, but they can use something else while driving, two-way radios. Sandra, who lives in Greece and used to be a bus monitor, asks, aren't they just as distracting as cell phones? Sandra listens to the scanners all day. She says she hears bus drivers using those radios a lot during their trips to and from school, so we listened in too.
From the first pickup,
ETA to 445 Westmont,
to the last drop-off, school bus drivers are chatting.
The house was dark.
It up.
My matron just went down in the snow. I got to secure my bus and get off.
We monitored two-way radio conversations for several local school districts. First and foremost,
to be clear, it's not illegal for the bus driver to do that anyways. They're allowed to use the two-ways.
Correct. They're allowed to use the two-ways. Just like any other motorist, they cannot use their cell phone.
So what's the difference? Kathleen Callen, transportation director for East Irondequoit Schools.
Cell phone is used for casual conversation. It's generally visual. You're looking to see who called. You're looking to dial a number based to 110.
For two-way radios,
the mics are mounted at a particular place. They're programmed directly to dispatch, so all they have to do is grab that mic without even looking, click the button, and they're immediately talking to dispatch.
Our viewer wanted to know if the two-ways are used for casual conversation, perhaps a distraction. Our investigation didn't find that. The talk, business only. And according to Callen,
really a piece of safety equipment. It's not casual conversation.
But they are used while the bus is in motion.
Very rarely. Yesterday afternoon, I had a driver on 490 that called in because she believed there was a drunk driver in front of her. Yes, she was driving down the expressway to make that call. Again, safety sensitive.
It's a two-way connection. Bus drivers depend on daily to keep you and your kids safe.
Those bus drivers, we are told, go through extensive training on when to use the two ways and when not to. Again, casual conversation supposed to be off limits. And it's not just schools. Businesses can use two-way radios as well. Consider them on truck drivers. You see them on the roadways often. I did some digging and found out anyone using two-way radios, really, or even ham radios, can do so legally while behind the wheel here in New York State. Back to you.
Very interesting. If you have-
back to us. So is that helpful or is that, more problematic? Cause, we hams don't get any training and casual conversation is what we're all about.
To a greater extent, I think the very significant point about that, and she did it very well, probably, and I don't know who prompted her, or hopefully she wasn't prompted, is she was very specific. We know where the microphone is. It's in a specific place. We don't have to make choices. You don't have to hold the device to your head to hear anybody. So your hands free for probably 90% of the activity, except for that 10% of, okay, base, we have an emergency here, and you communicate what you need to communicate. You set the mic down. So there's very much a behavioral context situation here in immersion that we've been doing for 70 years mobile, and I find it hard to believe that suddenly now we're a hazard on the road with as many millions of miles as most of us have enjoyed.
Yeah, if the cell phone and text thing hadn't come up, if it didn't exist, ham radio mobile operation and no mobile operation would suddenly become a focus because it's
right.
Our history has been it ain't a thing. But what do you do now? Because the texting is there, and now the public, which is the public and legislatures, which are not particularly discerning of one versus the other, are now it's on their radar. So what? That's where you are now, right?
That's where we are. And again, the question from the assembly in initial conversations with the assemblyman's chief of staff. And listening to their justification for, well, we only intended this to be a cell phone bill. Why are you guys making more of it than it is? I said, well, you know, your law enforcement buddies have had a different interpretation. And sure enough, 5 minutes later, talking to their law enforcement advocate, I said, well, yeah, we'd like to see no distractions while driving. It's part of the NTSB and HTSA initiatives to make and keep driving safe on the road. And when you start hearing people borrow from other people's initiatives as an excuse to do things without cause or reason, that's when you want to go back and look at, do the words match what's coming out of your mouth and what was in your head when you did this? And do you guys have any information that says that this activity from squad cars and fire engines to the trucker to the average vacationer crossing the state line to hook up with his buddies and get on a fishing boat?
That point's a really good issue. You know, we brought it up in our organization when it was later in 2016, and the early forms of the bill, as we understand it, did have exceptions for two-way amateur radio, mobile radio, commercial radio use. And then at the end, my understanding, or at least what I heard from some of the folks that are more involved in this, was at the end they kind of dropped that section out, in the 11th hour, where it did originally have that in there. And so the folks, like, as you indicated, like the truckers unions and the taxi cab unions and all of the people that are not in that one section of the exception that says, you know, if you're law enforcement, everybody else that has to operate a radio while they're driving for their work, they would have been up in arms in March of 2016 when this was first announced. Because it would impact their work.
Well, right. We, in part of that discussion too, you know, after the fact, we were being called upon to, well, where were you guys when this started out? This has been in wet ink since March. It's been through rewrites and revisions. You know, how come you guys and the big utilities like PG&E and SoCal and SoCalEd and other entities, how come they didn't come forward? And, you know, you guys knew this bill was in flight. And he said, well, it was a cell phone bill. The Assemblyman himself says it was a cell phone bill. There was no call to action there. And one of the things that happens in this state, and it was also changed at the same time last year, is that bills could be wet ink right up to the time of vote.
Yeah.
So, you know, things could slip. We call it gut and replace is one thing that happens with a lot of California bills. And we didn't have, nobody thought to look at it. Now there is a 3-day hold on any rewrite of a bill before the vote. So that will be made available to us. And the webpage that Gary brought up showing the bill has got a way to go track the edits and the language of the bill as it goes through, which all of us are trying to, you know, we've all subscribed to this because we want alerts if somebody touches the wording of this at any point. But, you know, to that, you know, where were we? Well, again, it was a cell phone bill. There was no cause for this. And even as the bill was written, you'd glance through it casually and go, well, it doesn't say you can't use a microphone. There was nothing explicit. And again, it was not until law enforcement agencies started giving conflicting interpretations and guidance to their officers on the street that we said, you don't know. Most of us drive through 5 or 6, sometimes some of us 10 suburbs or towns on our way to work, through 2 or 3 counties to get to work. It's kind of Russian roulette as to which one's going to give you a ticket for doing what you've been doing, you know, in your commute all the time. And the other thing to justify our existence, and we've been very careful not to be specific about exempting for ham radio because we are aware of a greater implication. And law enforcement and the assembly is in agreement with this, is you can't do, they don't want to do an exception for one specific working group or affinity group. Because if we got it as a ham radio specific exemption, chances are the Teamsters or the utilities, the commercial radio folks would come back in and go, but we need to use this for our business. Then somebody else would come in and go, you know, we're another hobby. And they don't. The ink would never dry on this bill, which is why we're trying to use our industry experience and examples drawn from other states to. And those are some of the attempts on the petition, is to throw out language that will stick in a fashion that says exactly what kinds of devices and behavior is prohibited, and how not to leave those loopholes in there for interpretation.
So let me get myself up to date. You are working on a new bill now, right?
There is what we were told is a placeholder bill that the Assemblyman has opened up, and that's why the last line in, if you look up Assembly Bill 1222, it's very sparse, but at the end there's a distracted driving, there's a line for distracted driving, which will expand into new language, probably taking the existing language and many edits that a few of us are putting in there to try and characterize this and get it down. There are 7 other states that I found that have exemptions, either some specific to amateur radio. I think five or six of them are not amateur radio specific, but do generalize and characterize two-way radio use as being an exemption versus the type of behavior and context of using a cell phone. So it is possible to achieve this. There's been model language out there before California dove into this. So you begin to see that something that started out as a good idea, somebody else says, well, hey, I got another idea. And, you know, it's like doing field day. Well, let's just do 3 bands and we'll put up dipoles. But I got a new tower. Let's start building things. And suddenly field day takes up a whole Disney park and, you know, 50 kilowatts of energy. You just got to watch that stuff.
Yeah. I'm trying to find the Assembly Bill 1222.
That's it. Yeah.
Okay. So it's got a lot of stuff in it because it's calling itself a driver's handbook.
There you go.
Okay. So there's.
Can I jump in here a minute?
Yeah. Norm's our expert. There you go. Number 4.
Okay. Go ahead, Norm. So it's not as big as I thought it was. Go ahead, Norm.
No. Assembly Bill 1222 is a placeholder bill, like Jim said. There's several different ways you can introduce legislation, but the 1222 is something that they introduced before the deadline to actually introduce legislation at the state capitol and pass. And they can amend it to mean something entirely different. It's just a placeholder, or what they call a spot bill. So apparently that's the vehicle they're going to use to, you know, hopefully amend the law favorably to permit, once again, two-way radio operations while driving. Make no mistake about it, and everybody in California or traveling into California should understand this. Effective January 1 of 2017, it became illegal to drive and operate a mobile device of any kind while you are behind the wheel and underway. That's how Bill 1785 became law, and that's how it was implemented as such. Now, our current status, we started this change.org petition a couple of months ago because, you know, the ARRL could not or would not respond to our numerous requests for involvement over this issue. We are all of the accord that, you know, we need to speak with a single voice on this particular issue, and the ARRL is best suited to do that. But they were nowhere to be found until recently. Now, I think because of the change.org petition, and other, you know, things that we have, steps that we've taken, they're now paying attention. Assemblyman Bill Quirk's office has responded to us, told us that we would receive updates from their office concerning this, and they enlightened us on the existence of Assembly Bill 1222, the spot bill to fix this. They also said that they're working on on language that would be issued by the Commissioner of the Highway Patrol in California that would be definitive insofar as what his interpretation of this bill is. And hopefully that will trickle down if it's favorable. Well, even if it's not favorable, it's going to trickle down to all the other municipalities, police and sheriff municipalities in California. The situation is very fluid. We're trying to get coordination of efforts between our group and I think Marty Knoll out of the Southwestern District Vice Chairman, ARRL Vice Chairman, I think out of the San Diego area, has been appointed by the ARRL to handle this further. We have in our possession Assembly District specific petitions that address the changes that we seek. We've made it easy for the legislators. We've drafted language to modify the bill. You know, we've done all the staff work for them, so all they have to do is just read it and say, yeah, that looks really reasonable, and hopefully move it along. And I was at a swap meet here in Northeast Sacramento yesterday, and I collected 81 signatures that were placed on Assembly District specific petitions for individuals that reside in Northern California. And some people came by the table and said, you know, I'm not a ham. I said, we don't care. If you're a registered voter in the state of California, you can sign it. As a matter of fact, we don't even have provisions on the petition for call signs, and we don't want call signs on there. We want registered voters from these specific districts to weigh in. And you know, we've networked nearly 1,500 people now, and we're adding more every day. And we hope that we'll be able to coordinate with our brethren in Southern California to jointly move forward and work with Assemblyman Quirk's office, who apparently is going to carry the water for an amendment to the 1785.
What part of California is he? Does he represent?
He represents people in
San Diego.
Fremont.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. No, go ahead.
Quirk is Fremont Union City.
Well, that doesn't help anybody from North Carolina.
Quirk is in Northern California, the Hayward to Fremont area on the east side of San Francisco Bay, whereas I'm in the south part of the bay. So he's not my representative, and he has no relation to the folks down in San Diego. They have another two or three districts down there that ARRL covers. So you know, there's no clear delineation. There's no equal delineation. Nor is there any all-state representation of amateur radio operators, because we have two ARRL divisions in many sections that may or may not communicate. There's no one way to get a word out to all hams in California, which is another benefit of having used change.org, because you get social media organic spread, and through Facebook is where most of that gravity is coming from, and probably generated, I'm pretty sure, judging by when I call the assemblyman's office and the receptionist answers the phone, I say, "Hi, this is Jim Aspinwall." They go, "Oh," they're exhausted answering the phone up there. And I said, I'm sorry about that. That's not what I asked people to do. Yeah. That's not what I wanted to have happen. I want you guys focused on fixing this, not answering the phone. That they know we're here, which is not a bad thing. And the next part of that is to work that into a positive relationship. We've left it that way. We've left an open door. We have a seat at the table. We hope to go to Sacramento and help if they need us, help get support for whatever acceptable changes there are. And that's probably the most important part here is that, or a very important part is that you've got global reach with some of these things. It does affect more than just hams.
I was going to ask about that. In fact, David, I've got two questions, allies and opposition. So I'll make you in charge of remembering the opposition part, and I'll ask about the allies part. And that is, you said that this affects people outside of ham radio, anyone who uses two-way in business or whatever. Are you working with those guys? Are they your allies?
As far as we know, we have been focusing this on our community first, because it's been so fluid, and I work full time, so I'm managing this in between conference calls and whatever Norm and I can do at night. There's a whole strategy sheet here. Certainly, the radio manufacturers have got some skin in the game, because if you can't use a mobile radio in this state, that's a lot of mobile radios that aren't going to get sold eventually, because people are going to replace their fleets. So they're on the list, and I just heard that a couple of people are reaching out to the radio manufacturers, some of which have got synergy between amateur radio and the commercial markets. A lot of the people that we engage with in our amateur radio work have got two-way radio shops and operate their own sites and businesses, and they're going to know the impact of this, so they're concerned. What we don't know, because last week there was a meeting, we don't know who the rest of the stakeholders are that they've been addressing. Certainly, I would hope the big utilities have come to bear. I'm pretty good at the social media thing and sticking with a lot of mass attention, because we're going to need everybody's support to get this passed when there's a new bill. And I'm especially interested to see that this is a fresh bill, and suddenly within a month of it ink drying and it taking effect, it's already been challenged. So the assemblyman's got a little challenge among his peers to work out, and is going to need support, because hey, Bill, you guys you just got this thing passed, and now you're coming back to get it changed. What'd you do wrong the first time? So we're going to cover the guy. You know, we need his support. He's going to need our support, and that's the bigger part of this this whole thing.
I don't want to draw a fracture line between the potential allies already, but I'm thinking everybody else can point to limited conversations, training, and hams are exactly the opposite. Unlimited conversations, no training.
Well, let me jump in here real quick.
I don't know.
This pretty much highlights a situation across America in all the ham communities. You just we have in individual ARRL sections legislative liaison representatives. They're supposed to be watching this stuff and to communicate to their sector managers changes or introduction of such bills that could affect the amateur community in their specific area. They need to be trained on how to go on the internet and, find their legislative pages and do keyword searches to figure out if there's anything pending. Clearly what happened in California, everybody said, oh, it's just a cell phone bill when it was issued last, March, and everybody quit watching, and then it got stepped on five times, and it was one of those holy cow things. It's too late to change it now. And this is kind of like a situation where you have to shepherd the thing from, birth all the way to through, its, growth period until the governor signs it. Just because you're a legislative liaison appointee doesn't mean you just can wear a badge and walk around a ham fest and look important. You actually have to do something. I've got an appointed position in my ARL section. And, it's not legislative liaison, but I'll tell you what, there needs to be people. If they're inadequate, they need to be replaced or educated as to how to do this. So it doesn't happen again, because folks, it happened in California and it could happen in your state too. And we have a full-time legislature here in California, meaning that meets yearly. Not bi-yearly like in some of the smaller, states with less resources, but still it could happen to you, and you need to be watching this stuff. And, I think, the lesson's been learned in this case here in California. And, we've created probably about 1,400 or 1,500 watchdogs now who are, that we know of. We're raising the level of awareness. We're raising the, the ability of people to, understand what's going on. I contacted some people at the ham swap yesterday. Didn't know a thing about it. And I had the bills pinned to the, a display board so they could read it. And then they wrote our petition. And then, of course, they said, yeah, I'll sign it. And he says, well, who's your assembly person? I don't know.
Yeah. I'm not surprised.
They never know.
I had the laptop computer. I had the laptop computer, and it was linked into the California Assembly website, and I was able to look it up for them to tell them.
Yeah.
Because, they vote for or against them once every 2 or 3 years, and that's it. So we're trying to educate as well.
I'm not surprised that the hams in your area were not. Yeah, I'm not surprised the hams in your area were unaware of the bill. Hams and the general public, don't pay a lot of attention to anything besides the absolute top level, if they're paying attention to that. So So we see this all the time. David, you've been trying we're going to do some training on assertiveness from co-hosts.
Yeah, I wanted to jump in on the ally side before we get to the opposition. We started talking about this. We've actually, in our Aries group in Southern California, we've been talking about this for two or three years, because there was a distracted driving bill in, I think it was 2015 that was passed or introduced, and may have been earlier than that. And at the time, the way it was written, we were exempt because push to talk wasn't included in that, right? And that allowed us and the truckers and the cab drivers and the, you know, public utilities workers the ability to continue what they're doing. And I know when we brought it up, or when this came up earlier last year, Marty Wall, who's the gentleman who's the ARL vice director in the Southern California area, who's working on that right now with the legislators, he brought it up, and at the time it had that exemption. It had the exemption for us out in March or April or May. There was language in there to allow us to do that. And I guess in September or so, it changed, you know, a week or two before it got introduced, and it came up. And one of the things that surprised them then was that the truckers, you know, unions and lobbies and the taxi cab and all the other people like PGE and Southern California Edison weren't at the table talking about this. And I know that they said that they had reached out, the section manager in San Diego had reached out to you know, his representatives, and it just kind of went past because it's hard to get to hold of enough people all the time really quickly to have them say anything. And, you know, after the fact, and in January, we talked about it at our meeting as well. And, you know, Marty said that they still really hadn't heard from any of those people, and they had reached out to them to get support. And really, mostly what we've been waiting for right now is for somebody to get ticketed, for them to challenge it. And I know, I think Jim, you mentioned that earlier on in the show, that's kind of what the ARL has been waiting for, a case that they could help adjudicate to see, is it right or wrong, or how it goes. And, you know, we've talked to various and sundry law enforcement here in Southern California, and as you found up there, you know, you talk to five different people and you get six different opinions. You know, the local, well, I don't want to throw anybody under the bus, but the folks that we work with down here, said in the LA area, said, they didn't see this as having applied with for ham radio, but if you go out towards San Bernardino in the desert, you know, that same organization, their public relations liaison said, oh yeah, absolutely. The way we read it, you know, push to talk is not allowed. And it is not covered. And it, actually, if you read into the law, there was some point where we looked at, there's a section there that says if it's not original equipment manufacturer. So if you read the law and you want to be a real jerk about it, if you go and replace your stereo head unit with a Sony or a Alpine or some other head unit, if it's not a swipe or a tap, you can't control that radio either, the way the law is written. And it was just written badly. And they've tried to get out to those people, to those other organizations, and they really haven't had any luck or any response. And I don't know if it's they're working on their own and they don't want to include amateur radio in their conversations, or exactly what the issues are.
Well, I think there are two key points of awareness that go both directions. Most of the people in a specific market are unaware of anybody, that there's another market around them. Certainly hams know that there's CBers, there may be some GMRS. We're aware that there's police and fire, and we kind of hold that all separately. And we've gotten, as you guys probably have, a lot of feedback that, you know, I'm Aries, I'm Racies, I do stuff with the sheriff, we're important. Well, yes, we're important, but that doesn't carry a whole lot of weight in terms of the fact that this is a safety bill. So how do you take what we enjoy and make it tolerable in a safety context when, of course, you know, you have those people who are victims of accidents, or, you know, Mothers Against Drunk Drivers, for instance, perhaps is looking at, you know, we want people focused on the road. So there's your you know, detractors that may arise from the situation. And go to the question we got from the chief of staff at the Assemblyman's office is, why are you guys different? Tell me how recreational use of your radio is justified. And there's the only thing I could come up with in that specific circumstance is not everything we communicate is immediately 911 ready. And especially if the infrastructure goes down, you're allowed to make a 911 call on your cell phone if there's a bona fide emergency. Great. Why can't we do that with our radio? Well, they're not saying we can't, but, you know, so if you're going to allow us to do it on a cell phone, but not a radio, but what happens when the cell phone infrastructure goes down and you can start building all these cases and you have to keep them very simple. And I'm diverting off the allies and the question here, but if you spend enough time on radio from a lot of the things we've all done, from broadcast to two-way, just general business two-way to public safety, you're aware there's a greater audience out there. I'm a part of an Airstream group that uses CB radios routinely as they're going down the road on caravans and going on tours to stay in touch, because you can't have 15 people pulling a trailer on a cell phone at the same time. That just doesn't work. So there's a lot of use cases there in state and out of state. Another thing that comes up with the ally situation, and it goes to dealing with your politicians, why we didn't get a whole lot of answers initially from the Assemblyman's office is we weren't voters in his district. And we're seeing that same kind of alienation or isolation or pushback or diversion even within the ARRL. And I don't want to call too much attention to that because we just need to fix. That's easier for us to fix than politics sometimes, is the guys down south aren't in our district, and our district people aren't responding, and we're waiting to see what happens. Now we go into, we don't know who else is at the table. We don't know who else has been in the Assemblyman's office since a month ago when we talked to them. So that's information. We want to go back into those meetings, and if we have to do it from back to, you know, our back-end conversations with friends in Neighbor, in APCO, in any of the ACS organizations we belong to find out who else is at the table. Certainly there are hands that work for PG&E and these utilities that that may have some awareness of what's going on. Google is a huge user of DMR globally, and so they have a stake in this, at least in the state as well, and it will trickle to other operations for these multi-state corporations and visitors to our, you know. How do you explain to somebody that's, you know, getting on an airplane to come over from the UK, don't bring your Bofang and expect to talk on ham radio because that's illegal in this state? You're going, well, I'm going to go to Orlando instead of Disneyland because I can still use my radio in Orlando. Somebody might make a decision about that at some point in time.
And there's another interesting set of allies out there. You know, I did some research around this as we were getting ready to have the show. And if you look at, there are bills right now being introduced in state of Washington and Oregon to adjust their distracted driving laws as well. And this specifically called out that it doesn't apply to ham radio or commercial two-way radio. It's right in the bills and the law. And I think originally that was in the California state one too. And for some reason it got dropped at the end.
Well, go
ahead.
That goes to this greater initiative at the national level that they know, okay, there's an initiative in D.C., a big national organization. Let's piggyback. Let's be the pioneer to be the first to implement that initiative, forgetting the unintended consequences and the collateral damage. One of the things that came up in Norm's part of this as well, they're looking to have a statement from California Highway Patrol or somebody in law enforcement. We asked if they would get an opinion from the Attorney General's office to dissuade enforcement or prosecution. And it would be really nice if the California Highway Patrol says our intent, we believe the intent is cell phone only. And as much, however they're going to word it, is basically tell people don't enforce this against two-way radio use. The CHP memos don't get to every law enforcement officer in the state.
Right.
So, and in an opinion, whether it's from the Attorney General or it's the intent that's written in the Assembly Library or from CHP, opinion does not change the material value of the law. So,
right.
We'll probably carry a copy of the CHP commissioner's letter going, hey, you know, the boss says don't, right here. And they go, I don't work for CHP. I'm writing you up.
And exactly. We in Southern California, the public relations officer with the Highway Patrol in Southern California area, we hams, we all carried a letter from him for a long time after the earlier bill passed. Mm-hmm. And it stated very clearly, and it actually, you know, it was a great letter because it had the section of the law that said specifically, doesn't affect, you know, two-way mobile push to talk radio, and we carried it around. And like you said, I heard from some hams that said, well, that's great for CHP, but I might have gotten pulled over by, you know, LAPD or the sheriff's department or some other municipality, and they don't care what the CHP says. And you know, we all know that even before January 1st of this year, if you were talking on your radio and you were distracted, you could still be ticketed for distracted driving, not for talking on the radio, right? This just notched it up a little bit. I can be not distracted and talking on the radio, and this just turned it into, doesn't matter what you're doing, you're talking on the radio, distracted or otherwise, you're getting a ticket.
There's another gotcha in here, which I've only heard hearsay that it's been applied, but it's our basic, say, speed law, in which an officer can look at road conditions, look at the weather, whatever is going on, and assess your speed versus posted speed, and within their reason of judgment, determine what a safe speed for the activity and the conditions they observe is. And there's at least the anecdote that there was somebody driving down the road on a posted 65 freeway, not misbehaving, no other reason, for, as we're told, to have been pulled over. Posted speed 65, vehicle speed 65, written up for recommended speed 0. So now you're stuck with 65 over the speed limit based on the judgment of an officer assessing your behavior, plus or minus the road conditions. So there's, if you want a scary nightmare, as is to Gary's heading of this, that would be it, is a ticket for 65 over, which is reckless endangerment.
And a lot of insurance points.
a lot of lawyer points and probably, you know, three hots and a cot for a while if it goes really bad.
You know, it's not clear whether a citation on this would cause points on your driver's license and therefore an increase in your insurance. That remains to be seen. You know, ideally, just sort of to sum up, we need to change the law. And hopefully we could change it to something that's agreeable to all parties and stakeholders. And we hope that the ARRL will favorably respond to our recent request to share information with the Southwestern District representatives that is apparently taking point on this. And because we're all on the same team, we're all working to the same end here. We have a network of a number of people now that will, they're subscribers to the change.org petition. We can hit a button and instantaneously they can contact their legislators and say, hey, we need to support this bill. And we need to be vigilant. Like I said earlier, this stuff about it looks good to me in March and then just walk away, that no longer applies. You need to watch every day to make sure nothing got changed or modified while you were sleeping overnight.
Yep. The ARRL has, I put up, while you were talking, a search. I just put in on the ARRL website the word distracted, and there's more than 9 screens worth of information, and the first one has just got, a lot of them. So they're paying attention, whether they're getting drilled down to exactly what you guys need or not, I can't say. But it's clearly an item that they're paying attention to. So how about that?
Well, we've written some well-pointed, well-targeted letters just recently to officials of the ARRL about involving our effort with their formal effort, and we hope that they will respond favorably to it. We'll wait and see.
Yeah. So is what you and Jim are doing, is it totally separate from any ARRL activity? Do you have a?
Up until recent times, it was the only activity that we're aware of that was in taking place in the state regarding any effort to change or amend this law. We've been begging them for the last 2 months to get involved with it, and only just recently have they stepped up and decided to assign somebody to involve the league and to do something.
Yeah, and actually, I got an email,
and
I, I forwarded the email to you, Gary, the Southwest Division e-communicator. You know, they send out messages to, by different region, and I forwarded that note on to you that came from our director, Richard Norton, and it talked about what's going on, what Marty's doing, and Len, WA6QHD, I know that they're meeting with those people and working on it, but like you said, it was one of these, like, after the fact, and it doesn't help because it already got there, and hopefully they'll be able to repeal it. I don't know whether or not it means we have to wait till 2018 for them to update or amend it or replace it with something else. I actually want to go back, Gary. There was something that you had mentioned about training, right? You know, we don't get training, and we're not you know, having short communications about logistics or other things like that, like law enforcement might or truckers might. But I wonder how much training do you think a taxi cab driver gets on how to communicate on the radio, or a public utility worker gets.
Yeah, I was listening to that as we were listening to that story on the school bus drivers, and they were emphasizing the training. That's probably about a minute and a half.
That's right, exactly. I don't think that they get very much training. I you know, I want to call BS there.
Yeah. Well, their training is policy and what's legal to hold their license and what they're expected. They're probably not trained on what the P2 button means on the upper left and talk around and those kinds of things. It's a policy tool for them.
Yeah, get a little bit.
But minimal.
So how about the opposition? Do you have identified opposition that is just staunch and making a stand, or is it more just kind of pushing your way through the jello?
Well, nobody, there hasn't been anything in, I would think, from the petitions and admittedly some of the ham radio groups, but there's a little spawn from other groups I belong to on Facebook. You would think that if an organization like MAD or somebody, I think people are kind of second guessing themselves if they were to oppose this based on cell phone use, because you get into this really gray, mushy area of, well, you can talk on your radio, why can't I use my cell phone? But there's qualitative and quantitative analysis that, studies have been done that clearly identify the types of behavior and activity cell phones in that context of opposition by peer or technical use. There's been no evidence so far, and nobody's even suggested that Mothers Against Drunk Drivers or any other affinity group is going to step out in front of this. Most of the opposition has been from, or not opposition per se, but question, why do you guys do this? Why is this a valid thing to do while you're driving? How do you answer that question? Which brings, you know, it's the same thing that happens with, so what is ham radio and why do you want me to get my license? It's anything and everything to everybody. I know hams who don't mobile at all, and I know hams that only mobile, or we've got 30 people here in our neighborhood who only got their ham license to participate in the CERT program. They're never on the air except for training operations. So it's really kind of hard to qualify or quantify where this fits. There are many, many, many much bigger issues in our society than whether somebody's talking on a microphone and, you know, coming off their dash in this case.
So what do you do? How do you answer them? What do you say?
Well, I think it goes to, normal, like this word, sort of an exigent circumstance of it's an available, ready resource. And like I said, there's a lot of stuff that we do that is critical situation awareness, BUCB or React with GMRS, a Red Cross worker on a windshield survey, whatever else. There are things that happen, skywarn alerters in the Midwest. I used to enjoy the heck doing that when I was a kid, is run around chasing storms. Oftentimes you can't wait or safely, conveniently pull off to the side of the road, hold that information for somebody who's looking for immediate situation awareness, and go back and re-engage and be efficient and effective. That's why two-way radio exists in the first place, is it saves time, fuel, it's more convenient, you get ready information at your fingertips, and that's borne itself out since Motorola put the first car receiver in a car.
And that's right. And, you know, most states, you know, California and I don't know, Gary, do you have hand plates? You know, most states provide a special dispensation. You know, I have personalized hand plates and they don't charge me like they do a regular personalized plates because some days down the road, they wanted people to have amateur radios in their car and they wanted to be able to, originally this started off as they want to be able to identify which car has a radio in it. That's why they started the amateur radio plates. And, you know, in California, you pay for a personalized plate, I think it's $20 or $40 every year to keep that personalized plate with amateur radio plates. It's a one-time fee, and they're there, you know, they're yours. You got to pay a license fee, but there's no extra fee for that vanity plate. And so you'd think it was worthwhile before. And, you know, my opinion is this is just, you know, legislature. They have to write bills. That's their job. And doesn't mean they have to write good ones, but that's, you know, that's what they do.
Can we hang our hook on MCOM entirely? Because that's not what we do most of the time.
No, because it's not all MCOM. It is situation awareness. It is tactical. It is, there's a strategic value. There's the very convenience promise of being able to communicate in your surroundings. With the recent floods we've had here, David, you probably had this experience as well, is we've got half a dozen mountain roads that are washed out. And sometimes you're escorting, you know, you're part of an escort to get people up that road safely, as much as my 30 Airstream buddies are making sure we make the right turn, you know, off the interstate to get to the campground. It's communication is a good thing. Over-communicating or communicating things like text messages about party last night when you're going to work, you know, it's a matter of context. It's a matter of circumstances and the degree to which a potential hazard exists. And again, there are no studies anywhere that anybody can find that this should have ever been on the books.
Yeah. I was going to say, is there any...
That's a really good point. Are there... Oh, sorry, Gary, go ahead. You're going to say
what? Is there any traction in saying, well, you're asking why we do it. What, when we turn it around, why not? Because you can't... We can't prove... We were talking before we went online... You can't prove a negative. We can't prove that it doesn't cause a problem, except there's no evidence that it does. So why are you lumping this in? It seems natural, but there's no evidence. Does that get you anywhere?
Well, we go to that takes us to the constitutionality. Is there a causal finding for this that justifies you bringing it to law? If there's no behavior, trees grow in my front yard. If there's no causal finding that, you know, the trees are not a hazard to people, then why would some city council even conceive of writing a law against trees? I mean, that would be crazy. Well, you know, I haven't bothered you at all. The fact that my house is kind of beige cream colored, you know, are you going to write a law about that? You don't write laws for things that are not, that don't need laws, which is an overreach. And in this case, we truly believe that this was unintended consequences. It was casual. It was kind of sloppy, and it didn't have the right players at the table. When you look at the number of things between agenda items of politicians and real business of state that go on, you really have to be very wary of what happens in all of this, and be a watchdog and advocate for yourself, be it your health care or your radio care. And I'm interested, David, this is the first time I've heard that somebody, your division down there, has actually been following this very closely. And unfortunately, there's a segmentation and isolation between districts and regions that we can't share this information. It all has to go through headquarters. And the wealth of information you guys have had historically, the more people you have watching this statewide, the more you communicate with statewide. There's the advocacy, again, that all of these assemblymen are going to need benefit from us, all of us, to get the new law passed. And if this was kept in a vacuum, if we had not heard that Marty had a meeting last week, we'd have thought we were still here as an island. And I can tell you, as we got traction, and there was, you know, he said, okay, I hit all my ARRL friends. Nothing. I talked to my DEC, my section emergency coordinator. I've emailed every ham club and person I can possibly think, even volunteer counsel, and got nothing. And I said, Norm, we're hanging out here on our own. You know, we got to have a better we really got to get serious about this story, because we're the only cowboys in the middle of snake country here. So it was reassuring to know that the ARRL stepped up, but we kind of listed, where the heck have you guys been?
Yeah, well, I'll forward you guys on the blast that I got from them, and I got it the other day, and I've been away camping. I would have sent it earlier to you guys. I was glad to see that they're doing it as well. And I guess, you know, the bottom line, you know, when I think about it, the saddest part of this is we're just a little section. There's definitely a big problem. You know, you see people driving their cars with their iPads and, you know, a hamburger and whatever, oh, yeah, all those other things. And I think we just got lumped in with all that. And otherwise.
Yeah. Right. The certainly the concern, because you'll see a lot of the arguments come up. Well, when are they going to make eating McDonald's illegal? You know, why? Yeah. When are they going to write somebody up for eyebrows and all those kinds of things? You kind of go, you know, you can keep writing laws, or you can put enough smarts in the hands of the law enforcers to make that smart judgment, which goes to some of that language in the bullet point in the petition, is make it very easy for the officer to do his job and not have to face roadside justice issues one way or the other.
Well, the reality is, if you look at the way the distracted driving laws are written, regardless of whether you're using a cell phone or an electronic device of whatever, it's already on the books. They can already write you for, you know, bad driving. You're bad driving, and it doesn't matter if a cell phone did it or a hamburger or, you know, you're putting on your eyeliner or whatever it happens to be. So, you know, this is, again, you know, back to my jaded law, you know, legislatures have to do something for a living, and yeah, they write laws, good, bad, or otherwise.
They call lawmakers. If you don't make one, I guess you don't get your bonus.
Yeah. Yeah, we could use a few less for my taste, but yeah.
So maybe there's something to that Donald Trump thing about.
They're paid to legislate. Yeah.
Eliminating two regulations for every one you create.
Well, yeah, and to the distracted driving thing, the other side of this, and it'll work for us, it'll work against us, is there's going to be a lawyer there who's going to stand up in front of a judge the officer doesn't show up in court to defend what he, to document what he observed, and somebody's going to get off on the hamburger situation, because a judge is going to go, I don't have time for this. I got three drunk drivers, you know, behind your case. You know, let's get this hamburger case off my docket, and let's talk about something serious. And that's, you know, some lawyer is going to make a good argument or bad argument in front of this, and why do this? And that's the one thing about, I'm almost thinking I'd like to go out on a road trip and be one of the guys to get cited for this.
I worried on the other side too, because, you know, I know they're looking for that case, and if that case that they find is the one guy that was out there and he was distracted driving, and the one, you know, highway patrol guy or whatever shows up is the one guy that had the dash cam, and it shows him weaving back and forth, you know, puts the nail in the coffin for us once and for all.
Yeah, yeah, you know? And the other part of that is
if I have bad case law out there.
Yep.
Right. Right. And if I was driving, you know, with or without my Airstream, if I'm on a road trip down to Inyo County or over on the other side of Mono County or something, and I got a ticket for this, well, am I going to take it to court? That's, you know, that's a day's drive down there, and I have to stay overnight, and a day's drive back. It's, you know, a $200 ticket's going to cost me $500, and there's no guarantee that I'm going to win when I step in front of the judge. So the culpability, the onus, the weight of the burden of this is still on the citizen who you have this great intent that you didn't mean for it to be about radios, but it turned out to be it is. You may have a great opinion from the Attorney General, the CHP Commissioner. No, we don't think this is a bad thing, but I'm sitting on a $200 ticket in another county. Okay, your opinion and your intent just cost me $200. So that's what we want to be careful of. We want to get people out of harm's way when they shouldn't even be there.
All right.
Yeah.
As often said, that as California goes, so goes the nation. That's certainly true in a lot of ham radio. In many cases, outside of ham radio as well. If you guys got a message to the rest of the country and maybe even the rest of the world, because this isn't just a U.S. consideration. There's cell phones everywhere.
Well, we're here on your show right now, so this is a starting point, and there are a couple more to come. So thank you very much,
Greg. Is it like a watch out, it could happen to you? I mean, there are states that have specific exemptions like California used to.
Education, awareness, and vigilance. Everybody needs to educate themselves on what their legislature is doing. They need to, educate themselves on how to communicate with their legislators. They need to know who their legislator is.
Yeah.
Until yesterday afternoon, there was about 100 people that didn't know who their legislators were in the ham swap. And, so that was educational for them. But they need to watch these bills and track them and do, word checks of, a legislation that's introduced in their various different, lawmaking houses. Make sure that, they're honest and above board and it doesn't affect them.
All right, but I'll play devil's advocate. So I just did a quick Google search, and according to Los Angeles Times, in 2016, California passed 900 new laws. So, that's every day almost 3 new laws were passed. How do you keep up with it?
I'm not suggesting you look at all 900 laws. Do a word search.
Yeah,
amateur radio, two-way radio, mobile radio, and any bill with those words in it should pop up in your search.
Yeah.
And you can better isolate it that way. Yeah, I'm not suggesting that you read through pages and pages of animal husbandry laws and stuff like that. Although it could very well be the way these the procedures are made, you could find an amendment to two-way radios on an animal husbandry bill. That's the way the rules work.
Gut and replace.
Yeah. Yeah. There's three ways in California to make a law change. And we talked about the spot bill. That's and apparently Quirk's office, Assemblyman Bill Quirk's office is sent out introduced 1225, which is the legislation to so-called amend. But there's another way that if that passes both the House and the Senate, the Assembly and the Senate, and the governor signs it, it'll take effect January 1 of next year. There is another way they can introduce, if it's past the deadline to introduce a bill, they can introduce it anyway, and it would be a 2-year bill. And Lord knows that's not advisable, because then you have 2 years to screw with it and to make amendments, and it wouldn't become effective if it was passed until January 1 of 2018. And the third way, and I don't think we're going to go that way, doesn't sound like it, we can ask that a bill be introduced with an emergency clause attached to it. An emergency or urgency clause attached to it means that it must pass the California Assembly and the California Senate with a 2/3 majority. If the governor signs it, it takes effect immediately. So as we understand the process, that is, the three options that are, available to us. And it sounds like they've already got a spot bill or placeholder there in Quirk's office that they've introduced, and we're going to go that route. And if we're successful in shepherding it through with agreeable language and the governor signs it, it should take effect in January of 2018.
In the meantime, watch your push to talk.
Yeah, well, our first petition, the petition we submitted, mailed in last week, was from 42 of his constituents asking for urgency clause consideration. So that has yet to be answered to. Now, what the requirement is to answer to it, what the handling is expected to be, I don't know, but I'm pretty sure that was some of those things coming across her desk were motivation for them to wake up and go, I guess we need to pay attention to these guys because they got our voters. You know,
<That's>
they know our voters. So our takeaway, from this and our leave behind in this case is certainly the education awareness. We all, you know, hams are lousy at communicating. You know, as much as we love our radios and we get to talk to people, we're horrible about communicating amongst each other. And this is a classic example of critical things. And it just doesn't have to be politics. It has, you know, it could be which repeater is down in the next town. So communication is the key, and social media gave us a chance. It can be used or abused, however you want. And I hope I'm using it smartly. Even if there is a bill, and if it comes out with really good wording next week, and it never gets touched until a vote, that's really great. But at that point in time and vote, everybody we've been in contact with also needs to go again to their senator and their assembly person and go, hey, you know, I was part of supporting this getting reworded. The reason it's coming to your desk is because it threatened me as a citizen for something I do every day. And I would like you, my local assembly person, to support this bill when it comes up to vote. So there's a lot of advocacy here that groups like the ARRL and the Red Cross and some of our served agencies, they can't do what we're able to do in drumming up this business and putting the word out. If you've had a little bit of media savvy, you end up finding you have a lot of media reach by accident or otherwise in getting word out. And that's we got their attention. There's good wording on the desk. We hope we want to be part of that wording. And then in turn, for what we asked of you, we're going to assume the ask of us is, what are you going to do to help support this if I'm going to all this trouble? And we're going to bring every vote in favor of this, you know, to the table that we can when the time comes.
And it'll be not emails, but telephone calls to their specific legislators, their assembly members, or their, state senators. Because the receptionist keeps a log right by her desk, you know, and so-and-so called from my district and said they want legislative member to support, Assembly Bill 1222. And actually even go a step further, ask them to co-sponsor it. That goes a long way. The more co-sponsors we get to a favorable bill, That carries a lot of weight with the legislators, and they can say, well, hey, there's a lot of co-sponsors. This must mean something. Maybe I'll walk down the hall and ask, Assemblyman Ricky why he's a co-sponsor. And, and it gets them talking within the state capitol about this sort of thing. So that's part of the process. And
so has this been a major civics lesson for you guys, or do you do this often in other areas?
Well, in a previous life, I did some of this on a limited basis. I was a labor union representative, so I did a lot of this, contacting of company officers when people were on the hook to lose their jobs. And, you had to put delicately worded letters together and even write opinions and appeal to arbitrators.
That's delicately.
Yeah. So, Jim, is this new for you, or do you do this?
Well,
you're in technology. You don't do this.
Well, this is my second time at bat with politics. Through technology, it brought me to media arts. I dabbled in drama or stagecraft when I was in high school, so I knew a little bit about presentation and the, these aren't the droids you're looking for, or maybe they are. And through technology, I came to be a seven-time author of consumer and technical PC books and a lot of reviews in the media, which led to some employment as a marketing person, a technical marketing person. So when you start combining all the nuances of technology and how do you make that palatable to the average human and convey that, you learn how to articulate things a little bit better.
I'm still trying to figure out how to do that myself.
It's a challenge every day. That's why we have good editors. So my editors made me look good. And I've had some of the best in the business from CNET and other major publishers help, and some very good marketing people who helped understand getting the word out. And social media. And I've been involved in social media since it was 300 baud dial-up modems and CompuServe and those things. So I know about, for every message you put out there, 10 or 100 people see it. You need to learn how to use that. But politically, I live in a small community that was part of that was still unincorporated. It was not a city. It was part of Santa Clara County that was due to be annexed by the city of San Jose simply because of arbitrary property lines and some other things. And we didn't want to go to San Jose. We like our little town of Campbell. It's very close. So I was one of three people that started an initiative to ask San Jose to let us go to the town that we wanted to be part of. And that was a 6-year battle of politic nuances, finding out city budgets, city services, who's got the best police response time. You dig in, you do your homework, you get your statistics. And when the opposing city comes and says, but we've got a great police department, we've got a great fire department, you kind of go, well, your run time to ambulance calls is, and your abandonment rate on calls is, and when you get the fire chief and the police chief going, where did you get those numbers? And I say, from your PIO's office, then you know you got them. So that's that was a pretty good object lesson, and it's just deja vu all over again, and some of the frustration of things.
So David, now I know why we're talking to these two guys, why they stepped up to do this, because they knew how.
Yep. And I'm glad you guys did, and hopefully we'll make some traction. And you know what, Jim? I got your PC Hacks book on my bookshelf somewhere in the office.
I was going to ask,
Do you have the Russian version?
No.
Suddenly no. It's important.
And I'd have to go digging around there to find it. But when you said that, I'm like, you know, that name sounded familiar. And I went and looked on your Amazon. I know I had that one for sure, and maybe one of the other ones as well.
Yeah. So you got me in trouble in job interviews too, because you try and go in and kind of just be a normal guy, and somebody says, I know that name, and they're Googling you going, are you the guy that, well, you seem a little overqualified for this job. No, I really need this job. I just wrote the book. I really need the job. So yeah.
Some of those books, are they current on the bookshelves to?
No, they're all out of print. I think I hold copyright of all of them. They funded my hobbies, and I am thinking of writing again in this venue. A great influence in my life, we were talking earlier about VHF versus HF, was Don Johnson, W6AAQ, who wrote a couple of stellar books of the pioneering of HF mobile and what, you know, HF basic, very basic HF antenna systems. And that helped me tremendously. And I want to work on a work in that nature there. And I also have a Tom Clancy novel somewhere in the back of my head, which all this politic is starting to, you know, really give me a little more creative juice.
All right. But, David, anything else you want to toss in here?
I think we covered it. I hope we can reboot this one in a couple months and crack open a bottle of champagne for our victory.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. Keep us up to date.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
We got Norman Lucas, WB6RVR. Let me promote you to full screen for the folks that are looking at the video. And Jim Aspinwall. Jim is N01BC, not N01PC. Thank you guys for explaining this situation to everybody out there. And we'll see what happens. And I'm going to drop you off the call and carry on with David for a minute.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. And thank you for your time.
All right. Bye-bye.
Excellent. Bye.
Bye-bye now.
One goes, and it'll take a minute for the
thing to promote.
Yep.
My tired camping eyes.
Yeah. So, how you doing?
I'm doing good. Been really kind of busy month, but I'm doing well.
Yeah, I thought I had escaped from Orlando with none of the crud that everyone else came back with, but it was just a delayed entry for me. It took another few days, and then sore throat for a couple of weeks. And this is why you haven't seen very much ham radio now. And a cold in the middle of that, and feeling generally pretty lousy. So
I saw a couple things come out.
A little bit. Squeezed a few things out. We missed you at the confab that Katie and Jason and I had there. on Friday morning. That would
have, I probably wouldn't have worked out timing wise for me.
Well, you weren't in Orlando, so
yeah.
Oh, we couldn't have Skyped you in because we didn't.
Right. Yeah. Well, it looks like you guys had fun. That was a good a little session there. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, had a good time, and I was glad to work with Jason. Gonna be working with Jason some and with Marty, the ubiquitous Marty Soloway, the chicken with fries, at Dayton, the world famous
Green County Ham Fest.
So we'll do the Hamcasters thing. I haven't mentioned Hamcasters much. It's a Reddit subreddit sub for those of you that do Reddit. Look for Hamcasters. We got to market that into a sort of an industry trade group.
There you go. It's kind of niche, but you never know.
Yeah. I got some heat on, somebody had flagged all of Jason's posts on Hamcasters for being self-promotion. So I had to go look into the concept of self-promotion on Reddit. And it turns out that's a thing. And Reddit doesn't want to be your free public relations company. So they have policies that say don't just get on there and promote your own self. They have this 9-to-1 ratio, 9 posts or comments or something that have nothing to do with you, things you know, but not whatever your project is. Mm-hmm. And then you can slip in one that says.
So you can't have a signature, every signature for every post saying tune in.
That probably would be okay. But as long as the post isn't the excuse to mention it. And so I started the Hamcasters thing because people on the main amateur radio subreddit said, we don't really want you on here promoting every show, but make your own subreddit and do it there. And I thought, oh, cool. Okay. And they've got lots of stuff about what content is acceptable. And I looked through all of that and it was fine, but I missed all of the self-promotion stuff. And then I came across it. Turns out it is unevenly applied, and the bigger a fish you are, the less it applies to you. But somebody,
probably take somebody to complain about you.
Yeah. Right? I think what happened is somebody came on there and posted a little YouTube video that they've made of just listening to a few minutes of shortwave radio. It wasn't a show. It wasn't a thing. It was just a little YouTube video. And I responded, and I didn't take it down. I'm the mod on Hamcasters. I didn't take it down. I just said, that's not really what we're here for. And we're here for people who are doing shows. And I equivocated a lot, saying, I don't want to be real heavy-handed about what things ought to be there, because as soon as I start defining it, someone's going to come along with something great that doesn't match the definition.
Right. You want to keep them included.
Yeah. But it should have something to it. Either a script or dialogue or editing or production or time.
Yeah.
And then if you've got something that is great but is none of those, well, maybe that's okay too. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe an intro and a close if it's something, you want people to see, but you got to explain what they're looking at, right? Yeah.
So, anyway, this guy took horrendous, typical Reddit offense. Typical of a small segment of Reddit and Twitter and a bunch of other, you see it on QRZ, although they mod QRZ harder. So typical of that small little instantly offended and way against the wall. I mean, he's just tore me a couple of new ones here every direction and then deleted himself from Hamcast. So it all went away. I saw it very briefly and then it went away, including my very measured toned explanation of what I thought, would be a good idea and what might not. Mm-hmm. So let's see. Are you, there we go.
Here we are.
Yeah. Things have stabilized again.
That might have been me. I might've clicked on something.
No, it's the 2-person, 3-person thing
on Skype.
On Skype. If you look at the, I got the bandwidth thing up now. And you can see things are very stable. Right? Mm-hmm. And you're not freezing. You're not,
you're getting good bandwidth for me now. Huh?
Yeah. I'm about a megabit.
Okay. Well, I was doing a little
over a megabit.
I'm doing a little Baker to Vegas prep, and I realized I cleaned my bench off partway because I needed to do some solder joints and make some cables up here and there. And I realized that the switch I had in here that I'm hardwired into, I thought was a gigabit switch, but it's not. So I'll replace that one.
We are so far below a gigabit.
You know? No, yeah, I know.
So unless there's something else that's going on, let's say.
No, I don't think there's anything else going on here, but just for all other things, and every once in a while I run a backup from here, and I should have known, because when I run a backup from here, it's really slow. So I'll upgrade that either way. Probably won't make it such a big difference for you, but it will for me.
The thing about the 2-person, 3-person Skype deal where it freezes all the time, I've got 2 other computers and 2 other Skype accounts, and I just connected myself to the computers that are sitting on...
Oh, just across the room
other
there.
Side of the room there.
Yeah,
And sat there and watched. And when I set it up for me, this computer, to one other computer, it looked... Look just like this, you know, look like this, you know, steady lines. I'm sending you better than I'm getting, but I'm getting pretty good. Mm-hmm. And as soon as I connected another computer, and I do it now. Yeah. I do it now, but I don't want to take the time. It all went to hell. The sending bandwidth, the receiving bandwidth, and the other two, the video from all three to the other three, all started with the freeze and then let go and freeze and let go. So it's a Skype. Feeling. It's a Skype thing.
Yeah.
So we'll probably try Hangouts. And there's going to be alternatives to Skype coming down the road.
Mm-hmm.
It's popular enough that there'll be some other things. Mm-hmm. So
it'll be just a great excuse to get Marty and Sterling on to kick something around again.
Yeah.
And that's always fun. They have a good time. They gave us a good shout out on the on their last show. They just posted up.
I haven't listened to that yet. Cool.
Yeah.
I haven't. The thing I don't like about Hangouts, and it's not that I don't like it. It puts big windows. It's not designed for broadcasters. It puts big windows in places you can't make them go away. And I can't bring up the screen that you've been seeing throughout this show, for those of you that are watching, that has all three of you guys at one time and then me in the corner. It's Hangouts for promoting to full screen is one at a time. I can switch them, but it's still going to be.
Can you do the Hollywood squares? Can you do
won't do that. So the folks, the shows that do that really well, the Twitch shows and stuff, they have multiple computers with Skype, one Skype on each computer,
right,
in one connection,
right,
and then they put it together through a switcher. And even more difficult is that they have an audio board that lets them do what they call mix minus, because I don't want to send your audio and the other guy's audio back to you. So with my little mixer here, I can color went to hell. I can select one group of audio to send back to you that doesn't include the other stuff, but not enough to be able to do that with 3 or 4 people.
Well, that's a lot more work too.
It'll be helped at that point to have a technical director. But if I had the mixer that would do that, I could preset it and still do it. But yeah, it's more money. So I won't. Your bandwidth is jumping up and down.
Once we start raking in the dough, we can do that.
Yeah. Your bandwidth is jumping up and down, but it's not freezing.
Mm-hmm.
And when it goes down to 500 kilobits, which is still a decent picture.
I wonder if it's when I'm quiet and you're talking, if it adds the audio in, is the audio when it...
I don't think the audio is, the audio is so small you wouldn't see it here. So what did you say about when we start raking in the dough?
When we start raking in the dough, you can get a TD and...
My TD moved out to Los Angeles. I'll send him over to see you. His name is
Cliff. We'll host him here in the garage. Yeah. We just have to clean up the other side.
Yeah. Cliff, W4FT, showed up on, he was at my very first, episode 1 and, helped out down in Orlando when I did that group, and he's TD'd for me, on 1 or 2 shows, and then he moved. So it won't help at all for him to be there, because the buttons
are all there with you. Yeah. You'd have to send all those buttons here, and then we'd have to host it from here. I don't know if I have the bandwidth for that.
I can show you the buttons, but why did the color go to hell on this camera?
Auto mixing. That's weird. Yeah, it does. It's not. That's not a happy camera. Is that what's one of those Logitech ones?
Yeah, let me see if I can get the right. See if I can fix it on the fly.
Maybe a reboot it. But I don't know that I want it to go to lose it and have it come back. There you go. Oh yeah. That's looking hot.
Yeah, that's not bad. That's almost flesh tones.
There you go. There you go.
Yep.
So next weekend.
Oops.
Oh yeah, sorry. Oh, there's my white screen there. Oh, there I am. So next weekend's Baker to Vegas, and we'll head out Friday and run the race all Saturday afternoon and into Sunday morning. And I gotta figure out a way to I'm gonna do some B-roll or something. Maybe bring some of that back, highlights or something, and might be interesting. And we are in the middle of nowhere, so getting you connected in is just not going to happen. Although we have been doing some testing with Verizon, and they're going to bring in a cow or something. Or like a, I think he said it's not really a cow, it's some kind of satellite type thing.
Of like the starting line?
No, we work in the middle. We work stage 9 in the middle of Chicago Valley. About 70 miles into the race.
Is the starting line anywhere in civilization and then it leaves civilization?
No. Well, so it starts in Baker. Well, it doesn't actually start in Baker, California, but it's called Baker to Vegas. It actually starts about 24 miles or 20 miles east of Baker. And it's kind of a wide spot in the road where there's a Bureau of Land Management kind of parking lot, so the off-roaders can go driving through the Mojave Desert there. There's nothing there. There's a couple trash cans and some Andy Gumps and a sign. So yeah, so if you look at one of those pictures, the top one kind of shows you where it starts. And so you'll see Baker High School, and the, you know, stage one is that 24 miles, I guess it's north from Baker. And we're in stage 9 there between Shoshone, so almost at when you get to the Nevada border there, that's stage 10.
My cursor keeps disappearing from this thing. Let me see if I can make it come back. Show cursor, showing where people. There's there the cursor. Is. Okay, so stage 9 is up there.
So stage 9 is up there. It's a long... You know, you see that straight line there between stage 8 and stage 9, and it's amazing when you see something like on a map like that, and it's uphill from 8 to 9, and you literally, it's a straight line, and you can literally see from our stage, it's like 6 miles, you can see the other stage just down the hill, and the slow cars and the flashing lights just kind of creeping along.
So what kind of radio coverage is there across this whole thing?
So let's see, can you see IBEX? So between 4 and 5 IBEX pass, there's that little X there. There's a high spot on the mountain at IBEX, and they'll put some, they'll bring in some mobile towers, and they'll put a repeater up there, UHF, VHF repeater for, coordination. And then somewhere on the, I think it's near Pahrumpth or maybe towards Mountain Springs, they put another repeater up for the second half of the race. You know, UHF, VHF coordination for the race there. And with IBEX, they can talk to Vegas and most of the stages from 9 down. And then on the other side of the hill, I think it's Mountain Springs, they can talk to 10 through the end. And so they just coordinate that way. This year, there's actually been some additions. The County of San Bernardino, that's the California side, has added the requirement this year that there needs to be an MD physician at every stage, where in the past they've used EMTs and paramedics. So some of my friends that are really heavily involved in the race, they're coordinating with Rockwell and Harris Radio, and they're going to have some NVIS communications from those doctors that are each one of the stages to one of the local hospitals over a HF, and I think some microwave links as well. There's a lot that goes on at the race. There's a whole lot of coordination.
It sounds like a ham radio documentary.
It really could be, and I don't know, this year I've got my hand so involved in that particular stage doing so many different things that I'll be able to shoot some video there. It'll be really cool, but maybe next year or the year after that, when our team starts to break up and they replace it with somebody else, that might be a fun thing to shoot all along the way.
If only there were some people in the Southern California area who had expertise in media creation.
I think I know some folks. I'll talk to some guys. So one of my really good friends is a video editor. I might talk to him about setting this up for next year. It's too close now to make anything really big happen, but that could be a cool thing for next year.
Yeah. I mean, I would love to do it when ham radio now starts raking in the dough.
Yeah, we start raking in the dough.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's a great course. You know, I see just a little part of it. 2 years ago, I had the honor. I'm not sure it was an honor or not. They adjust the way the race goes all the time. And so 2 years ago, they had one of the hams from each stage follow the last group, the last runner from their stage to the next stage and hand them off. And so, you know, at our stage, that's about 11 o'clock at night, and you get to go 6 miles to the next stage. That's where 10 is. And 6 miles doesn't sound like anything, except you're following the last runner in the race to that stage at about 3 miles an hour, or maybe it was like,
That's not a runner anymore.
It's yeah.
And maybe these guys are all athletes, right? I mean, this is not.
No, they're all law enforcement. They're all.
Oh, okay.
To run in the race, you have to be a law enforcement officer with the power to enforce and arrest. That's the way. And I know there's a little more detail around what it is that you have to do to be able to do that. But yeah, it started LAPD and Los Angeles Sheriff's Department, but there's, you know, from all across the country. In fact, there'll be a number of international teams as well. You get FBI, you get corrections departments, you get all sorts of people. There's about 300 teams. And at some point in the middle of that desert where there's nothing, I think they say 15,000-20,000 people will show up in that, you know, 24, 36 hours worth of time, because, you know, the 300 teams of runners and there's, you know, 20 stages. So that's, you know, you do the numbers there. And then there's all their family and support and handoff people. And each one of those teams have their own amateur radio support people as well. So it's just a lot of people.
Death Valley is somewhere in here.
Death
right?
Valley is, well,
just above Pahrump, I guess it's.
Yeah. So it's more to the west of what you're showing. Like Shoshone, there's that road up from Shoshone. And
oh, that's right. Yeah, that's
so if you go up from the road from Shoshone there, you'll get into Death Valley.
Okay.
Yeah, up that way. This is a different part.
But this isn't in the heat of summer.
Yeah, and in some of the previous years when we did this, they were doing it more later in April. Yeah, I know one of the years we were out there, I probably hit 105 during the peak of the day, and there were a lot more ambulances and a couple of medevacs here and there at even our stage, you know. And that's primary our mission there is we do the timing, runners in, runners out, we do all the logging, and we're there to support the medical teams if they need to coordinate getting an ambulance or a helicopter or whatever it happens to be. And, you know, a lot of other little stuff, like, you know, we'll tell a stage, hey, there's an ambulance coming through, you know, your direction or coming back the other direction as well, so that they know to clear the road, because, you know, any given time there's, you know, 100 people standing in the street waiting for somebody to come through.
How are the comms for the other people? Do they have their own systems? And
yeah, so most of the teams have they'll have some kind of radio communications within themselves. So a lot of the groups will use Sheriff's Department, not Sheriff's Department, the DCS, or they have their own amateur radio teams that work with them, and they'll put a ham or two here and there, and they monitor on another frequency. And so if they have a problem in between stages, they know who and where that they can call for help and support. Some of them have, you know, they'll do FRS radios. Some of them will bring commercial radios.
Does anybody have an extensive enough network to cover long distance? I mean, do the chips, California Highway Patrol, do they have radio coverage literally statewide? Because there's so much of California that's empty.
Yeah, they do. You know, so out there, they've got the really long, big whip antennas. And I don't remember exactly which frequencies they're on.
Oh, that would be low band. Yes.
Yeah.
6 so meters, 46 megahertz.
Yeah, I think they're like 6 and 10 and 11. And those they're not all UHF, VHF. In the cities, they are. But when you get out there, you know, and those cars nowadays have 3 and 4, 5 different radios, you know, they're covered with, they look like porcupines.
They're,
you know,
distracted.
Yes, they are distracted. They absolutely are. But nobody's writing them tickets. And it's one of those things we talked about that with our group of like, we always caravan out there because there's a big bunch of people that go to our group, and we'll have a big barbecue on Friday night getting ready. And I'll be on my radio all the way out there talking back and forth with the rest of our team. And actually this year I'll have 2 hams along with me in my vehicle. So I might have the kids talk on the radio instead of me, but I know I'll get on there as well.
But that'll be fun for them.
Yeah. Well, they've all, my 2 older kids, Ian's done it twice, and I guess Gwen's done it twice as well. My dad did it 1 year as well. He's a ham.
Now, are they going to just be hanging out with you, or are they, now that they're licensed, are they going to be able to be a bit more satellite?
Well, so, you know, the first year that Ian came out, my son, we cooked for the stage, and, you know, it was kind of a Boy Scout project for him. It was a, you know, Boy Scout service project. He needed like 6 or 7 hours. So, you know, we shopped and he made sandwiches and whatever for everyone. But, the last couple times they went, we work with the hams that are doing the logging. You know, we log all the miles when they hit a mile out. And we log all the runners when they come across the stage, and they've worked with the hams, to, you know, write the numbers down and do traffic. Cause, you know, you can do traffic as long as somebody, there's a control operator there, you know, monitoring you. And, this should be their first opportunity to
need
do
you.
It. Yeah, that's right. They don't need dad anymore.
Their call signs have come in, haven't they?
They have their call signs have come in, and we immediately put in for their vanity calls that they wanted.
Okay.
So they are in progress. Well, Ian is, KM6IUX. And Gwen is KM6IUY, and we're waiting.
Yeah, those are fairly terrible.
Yeah, they are. Well, you know, all the ones that are given to you. I have a couple of friends. I have KK6FUN. David Hartman got a good one.
Yeah.
Somebody's
going to think that's a vanity.
Yeah, and it's not. And then I have a friend KJ6TTT. He likes that call sign. That's a good one to get.
I had a friend in Chicago. His call sign was WA9NNN. Mm-hmm. And he had a mild stuttering problem. It was fun listening to him
try to get it out.
Try to say his call sign.
Yeah. But we'll see. I'm hoping. I did my research, and I checked, you know, all the different ways I could to see if anybody else had the calls. And the one Gwen wanted was...
Don't say canceled. Someone's going to go. Well, I guess if they've applied
I'm already in. It's already in. The one Gwen, I won't tell you until it's official, but the one Gwen wanted was canceled in 2007 or 2008. So I think that'll be okay.
Yeah.
And the one my son wanted, wasn't ever issued.
1x3s or 2x3s? Or?
Yeah, you know, so there are only techs. So yeah, 1x3s.
Yeah, they can get 1x3s.
Yeah.
With a 1x3, they could sound like they were licensed in 1946.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe 47.
So I do, right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Did they apply for 6s or did they have to go out of zone?
One did and one didn't. One of them had to go out of zone because the one that they wanted wasn't available.
You couldn't get them to go for the same suffix with just a different prefix.
Yes, we tried.
You wouldn't want them to get DHGs because they're not David.
No, not at all. They, we tried, you know, you try a November, you try a Kilo, you try a whiskey. And, none of those came out in the 6s for my son for what he wanted. And actually he had 2 possibilities that he was looking for. And all six of those possible calls were currently active and assigned. So we went elsewhere. And when we do the big reveal later on, you'll see they're all very similar to other calls that we have in the family.
Okay.
In fact, they're both one digit different.
Yeah. And it's
somebody else.
If there's somebody who's still hanging in with the show,
I think there are, let me see though, according to this, there are still seven.
Well, and I'm not talking necessarily about the Facebook Live guys, but hi guys. I'm glad to have you. Glad to have you still here. It's, you know, there's just the viewers, you know, cause it falls off.
Yeah, of course.
After it falls off at the 10 minute point. And it holds in pretty well, you know, like about 20%, 20-25%, make it to the bitter end. Mm-hmm. We like you bitter enders. If you're a new ham, or thinking about it, get that vanity right away. You will, you'll develop not only an affinity for the FCC issued call sign that you shouldn't have because it's probably terrible.
Yeah.
But it'll lodge into your identity with email addresses and stuff too much. So do it.
You know, the frustrating part about that, you have a 2x2, so you're in the same situation as I did. As soon as I got my vanity call, I had a Gmail with my original issued call, and that's 6 characters long. And as soon as I got my vanity call, I went to try to Gmail and do my vanity call, and they won't let you do a 5 character long email. It has to be 6 or more.
Google. Yeah, I got that problem.
Yeah.
I have an email address that is KN4AQGary, which is, I don't promote that because it's, I have my ARL alias point there. And so that's the only one I tell people.
And I tell you, I sent numerous emails to them, to their support and heard nothing back. And, you know, after our interview today, I'm thinking change.org petition. Cause I bet I could get a lot of hams to sign up for that. Cause you know, all the extras and anybody who's got a vanity call would love to have.
I don't know why they have that limit unless they've got a group of elites that they hold out the short emails for.
I wonder too, because I know there's no W0DHG@gmail.com. There's no reason why anybody would have that. But
that is a nice thing about ham radio call signs is that they are almost completely unique as identification of some kind. And, you know, when email and all that stuff started, it was a hobby for me. So KN4AQ became the identification for all of it. It was almost hard to extract that and get back to something more professional. It took a while.
Yeah.
When it became a business thing. Because I didn't want to be emailing my clients KN4AQ.
Who's that? What is that? Yeah. Yeah, I will occasionally give out my ARL email address because it's easier than way shorter than my, you know, David@goldenberg.net. Although it's easy and logical. And if you just wrote down what my name was and I spelled it right for you, that's really easy. Just put an at and .net at the end of it. Sure would love to have that. mycall@gmail.com. Yeah. I got it at outlook.com, but nobody uses outlook.com.
I do. I've got Outlook. Yeah.
Do you?
It's good. It's better than my Gmail.
Is it?
Oh. Yeah. It's Pearce 10, the incorporation of my business. That Pearce 10 began as my AOL, which was one of the first. I had a local ISP for a while, then I added AOL because it was more reliable. So, even early on, you know, Gary Pearce was gone. So Pearce was gone, but Pearce 10 was available. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, well, I was going to incorporate my business. You know, it's not, you know, really a business name I'm going to be selling to anybody. So I'll use Pearce 10. Cool. That sounds good. And you know, 10, you're a 10.
Right.
So that, as early as I was in Outlook, my name, any derivation of my name was gone, but Pearce 10 was available. So I got that, but it was not available on Gmail. Couldn't get it there. So it's G Pierce 10.
Somebody else had that.
Yeah. Huh. And G Pierce 10 is really hard to explain to people. It turns out.
Right. So. Yeah. What's the 10 mean? You're the 10th.
And then is it T-E-N? Is it T-E-N? Is it, but my wife's is worse. So
uh-huh.
What can you do?
Yeah, you just run with it.
Yep. Well, let me go cook this in the editor and get it online.
Okay, you very
guys,
good. Well,
you guys watching Facebook, you got, you know, the live thing.
Yes, once they do. Again,
good for you. And I noticed that in the picture we've got the split screen, East and West Coast Arvins are side by side.
They're right there.
Yeah.
So, couldn't have planned it any better.
So perfect. So so y'all, if you enjoy the program and get something out of it, and for those of you that made it to this point in the program, clearly you enjoy not just the content, but the bantering personalities. The bi-coastal nature of the program now. HamRadioNow.tv. Stop by there. And for those of you that haven't done it already and you're working on an excuse. And Patreon, dollar a month. It's a monthly deal. PayPal is available for an individual contribution, ordinary credit card. And then that guy that sent me the check. My address is in there. You can mail a check. You want to make it easy, you know, just fold up a $10 bill in a piece of paper and you know, stick it in there, because it ain't going to get stolen.
Yeah, it'll make it there.
Yeah, it'll make it. You could do that too. And guys handed me cash at Orlando. That was fun.
Oh, cool.
I didn't take an Arvin with me. I got to get a road Arvin. I went by a Walmart to see if I could pick up a replacement or a temporary standby Arvin. I need a plastic one because he's porcelain.
Yeah, mine too. It's small and porcelain, but yeah, you want to find a plastic one.
Yeah.
Or like a stainless steel one.
Is that okay with you, Arvin? Could I take another guy on the road in your place? It's not quite as, I'm getting a stink eye.
There you go.
But I went to a Walmart and they didn't have any piggy banks. I could have gotten any color Barbie you wanted. American Girls or whatever, but no, nobody does piggy banks anymore.
Amazon.
Yeah. Cindy was thinking about what store she could go get something that she didn't need instantly. And I'm saying, Cindy, if only there was this place.
Do you do the Prime?
Yeah, I got Prime.
Yeah. I know. There's seven of us in our house, and that Prime truck is stopping here pretty much every day.
Yep. We're not every day, but we're a couple times a week.
Yep.
So it's good for UPS.
And some days they say they're stopping here and they come the next day, which annoys me, but it's whatever it is.
You can get them to send you a text message when they're coming.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I mean, they'll text the hell out of you. We're coming tomorrow. We're coming today. Okay, we're coming in an hour. Okay, we came. It's there.
Every once in a while, I think I'm going to try out the locker thing, because there's the 7-Eleven across the street from my work has the locker thing. And I think if I really have to have it, I have it go to that locker. It's way closer than.
Yeah.
I don't know.
If it's going to make it before you go leave for the day.
Yeah.
Because
that's
most of the deliveries we get are 3 o'clock or so.
Mm-hmm.
Once in a while comes really late. All right, let's wrap this thing up. Tell people who the heck you are.
So I'm David Goldenberg, Whiskey Zero Delta Hotel Golf.
And I am Gary Pearce, Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec. Over.
And out.
Bye.
7-3 all. There you go. Check out Prime. There's a rubber piggy bank there. $18.
Bye-bye, Facebook.